Proof by induction is one of those weird little math things that if you do it right, you kind of don't even realize you did anything. And if you do it wrong, you know you did it wrong because, well, none of the math works. And you get like 3 equals 7. You're like, oh, I guess I was wrong. So there's three basic steps for proof by induction. The first thing you're going to do is you're going to check for a base case. Usually that's going to be k equals 0, but it might be k equals 1 or 2, whatever. Generally, we're going to be looking at these for things that are integers. You're going to assume it works for some value of k as a second step. And then for the third step, you're going to say, well, if we assume that's true, can we also prove that it works for k plus 1? So the idea is that if you can prove it for k equals 0, then if you can say that it works for k plus 1, then that would be it works for 1. And then if you can prove it is for, well, then you can, yeah, hold on, let me try this again. If you can say, okay, well, if I assume it works for k equals 0, or I prove that it works for k equals 0, and then if I assume it works for some k, then it also has to be k plus 1. So then you could say, well, I could pretend that that k was 0, so now it must work for 1. Oh, now it's at 1, so it must work for 2. Oh, now we're at 2, so it must work for 3. Oh, now we're at 3, so it must work at 4. So that's what proof by induction is. And again, it's one of those things that sometimes if you do it right, it's super elegant and doesn't actually look like you've done anything. But we'll do a couple of examples between this and some other videos to get you started. So let's look at this one, and we want to say, go ahead and prove this by induction. So the first step is to show that it's true for some kind of base case. And in our case, if we look at what we have going on here, j is going from 1 to n. So our base case here would actually be for n is equal to 1, because then it would be just the single term, j going from 1 to 1. So what we're going to say is everywhere we see an n, we're going to put a 1. All right, now this is still here. And we have negative 1 to the 1 times 1 times 1 plus 1, the quantity 1 plus 1 divided by 2. All right, so on the left, since there's only one term and it's 1, everywhere we see a j, we're going to put a 1. And we have 1 squared. And we want to know, we should put a question mark here, is that equal to what we see on the right, which is negative 1 times 1 times 2 over 2. So this is going to be negative 1 on the right. Is that equal to negative 1? Yes, it is. All right, so we proved it for the base case. All right, now what we're going to do is we're going to assume, actually, I'll try and keep this up here. We're going to assume that is true for some unknown value of k. True. We're going to assume that this is true. We're going to assume that it's true that if j goes from 1 to k, and all these stay as j's because they're inside the summation, and again, all of our n's become k's. So we're going to assume that this is true, and we do know it's true for at least one value of k. It's true for k equals 1. So we're going to assume that this is true. And again, everywhere we saw an n, we put a k. Okay? Now our goal is to show that it's true for k plus 1. So what that means is we want to show that it's true. So this is our goal. I'm not actually going to say that this is true. We want to say, is it true that for j equals 1 to now k plus 1, negative 1 to the j squared. Is it true that that's equal to, now again, if we have a k, we're going to put a k plus 1. Is this true? K plus 1 plus 1, 2. So again, everywhere we have the k, it's now a k plus 1. So k plus 1, k plus 1, and k plus 1. All right, so that's our goal. Now, solving these, it's always something different, so really you just want to start playing with it and see what you can get. So we're going to start, and I'm going to start with the thing on the left because I can probably manipulate that a little bit better. So what I want to do is I want to perturb the sum. I want to pull out the k plus 1th term. So this will be j going from 1 to k, j and j squared. And I'm going to pull out the k plus 1 term. So everywhere I see a j, I'm going to put a k plus 1, and then times k plus 1 squared. Okay? Now, I do have this assumption here. So I assume that this is true which means that I can go ahead and I can make a substitution. So since I've shown that this, or I've assumed that this here on the left is equal to this here on the right, that means that I can take this and I can plug it in here directly, okay? So that means that I can say, well, this here on the left is fine. I can leave that like that forever because that's what I really want to do at the end. So I've got negative 1 to the k times k plus 1 over 2 because that was my assumption. Now I've got negative 1 to the k plus 1 over k plus 1 squared. Now, I got to look at my goal. I'll erase this now. My goal is that everything on the right is going to be over 2. So I need to be able to combine these eventually. So I can go ahead. I'm actually going to go ahead and simplify this a little bit. Okay. So I've got negative 1 to the k. And I'm going to separate this out. Because if I go like this, I'll have negative 1 to the k, and then the 1 here, so this is equivalent. That will allow me to combine some things. I'm going to go ahead and say k squared plus 2k plus 1, and I'm going to go ahead and multiply the top by 2 and multiply the bottom by 2. That way I can actually combine those terms. Okay, so now I have negative 1 to the k, which is kind of a common term, I guess, that you could say that I have. Then I have k squared plus k, that comes from here, and then I'm going to distribute the negative 2. If you're not following the algebra, you probably are not needing to be doing proof by induction because it is an algebra heavy thing. So if you're still struggling with the algebra, you want to take a little bit of time and make sure you've got your algebra strong. So I take that negative 2 and distribute it across all of those terms. Negative 2k squared minus 4k minus 2. Okay, so that goes on top. It's all over 2. All right. So I have negative 1, and I'm realizing now I should have done something else with that negative 1, but hindsight's 20/20. That's okay. Negative k squared minus 3k minus 2. Okay. And that's kind of obnoxious, so I'm going to pull that negative 1 out. So I've got negative 1 to the k times negative 1, and now all of this is going to be positive. All that over 2. And just kind of like how I undid it before, I can put those back together. So I can actually get that this negative 1 is now to the k plus 1 power. And I'm actually almost done. You can't tell by looking at it, but if we go and we look back at our goal, let me zoom out a little bit. If we go and we look back at our goal was to determine that we had something that was in the form k plus 1 times k plus 1 plus 1. Now if I multiply that out, that's k plus 1 times k plus 2, or add those together and then multiply it out. So that is actually going to be my k squared plus 3k plus 2. So I'm actually already there. I just have to show the algebra to get there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go ahead and, factor. So I'll pull this back in a little bit. I'm going to factor, so I've got k plus 2 times k plus 1. Actually, I'm going to split the order just so it's super clear. K plus 2 over 2, and that equals negative 1 to the k plus 1 times k plus 1 times k plus 1 plus 1 over 2. All right, and believe it or not, we're done because that was our goal. And if I compare... Come here, girl. There we go. If I compare my goal, this is my goal here, and this is what I got. I achieved my goal, and so then we say QED, which is Latin for mic drop. It means I did it. It means deal, and I'm amazing. And yeah, that's the problem with proof by induction is you do this math, and you're like, but I got the answer that I already kind of knew, except you didn't know it was your goal. It was your goal. It wasn't something you actually knew. It was you used your assumption here to get to the goal, and that's how the induction happens. So if you feel like you did this and you're like, I don't feel like I did anything, that's totally normal for induction proofs. So again, the idea is that you're going to start off by showing that something is true for the base case. So something is true for the base case. And then you're going to assume it's true for some random k that's an integer. In our case, everything we're looking at is going to be integers. And then if you say, okay, well, if it's true for k, can I show that it's going to be true for k plus 1? Because again, the idea is here I showed it's true for 1. So it's like, okay, if I assume it's true for 1, is it true for 2? Yes. So now that I assume it's true, is it true for 3? Yes. Now that I assume it's true for 3, is it true for 4? Yes. And that keeps going and going and going forever. So there's your first little example of proof by induction.